Okay. Okay, so I will present this work, which is a work with Jean-François Aujol and Arthur Leclerc at Institut de Mathématiques de Bordeaux on the study of the geometry of non-convex inverse problems in infinite dimension. So I will jump right into it and... okay. So the starting point of this work is the following. So what do these several inverse problems have in common? So I have the problem of low rank matrix recovery, where I have a low rank matrix which is the product of one tall tall matrix here and another matrix here with a rank R, which I observe partially, and I want to recover the low rank matrix. I have the problem of recovering spikes of the grid from low pass filtering of these spikes. So there is a degradation of the original signal, and from this degradation, I want to recover the spikes. I also have problems of estimating Gaussian mixture parameters from compressed database, which is a problem in a space of measures. And in all these problems, I have an unknown that I want to recover with, and this unknown is parameterized by a few parameters. So the unknown will belong to a low dimensional model. So what do these problems have in common? They can be modeled as linear inverse problems with a low dimensional model. In all these models, the model can be parameterized smoothly in RD. In all these problems, we have recovery guarantees of a non-convex functional under a given number of measurements, which is theoretically or practically of order of the dimension of the low dimensional model, the number of parameters. And there are some theoretical studies of non-convex optimization techniques for these problems, or there are non-convex optimization techniques that are used in practice and they don't have a theoretical study. So my objective here in this talk is to study the performance of non-convex techniques to solve these inverse problems under the same general non-convex framework. And this study will permit me to give new results for examples where there weren't theoretical results. So in this talk, it's for Gaussian mixture model estimation. So I will start by describing what non-convex method I will study in this presentation, and the main tool that I will use to study theoretically the geometry of this problem. And this tool is the restricted isometry property. So the setting, I want to measure an unknown x zero, which can be a signal, an image, an object of interest. And when I do linear measurements, what do? I take my unknown x0, I project it on several functions or vectors in finite dimension, and I add
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Add noise object, which belong to a dictionary.
Jan, we have lost you during 1 minute.
Okay. When did you lose me?
That slide was okay. The next one. Yeah. Oh, don't go too fast. So the one with the measurement. Yeah, that one. I guess that after the first bullet, we lost you.
Okay, I was still on the first bullet. So.
Sorry. Sorry, I was not very. So no, it's okay. So can you just summarize the first bullets again?
Yes, no problem. Sorry for the network of my lab is not very stable apparently.
No problem.
So we measure an unknown x0 by several projection on functions or vectors infinite dimension, and these vectors here alpha L belongs to a dictionary D. Where I have m measurements, and I can summarize this by the equation y equal linear operator A applied to x0 plus a noise E. So this model, we can make sense of it when the dictionary D, when the functions on which we project belong to a Banach space, and the unknown belong to the dual of this Banach space. So locally convex topological vector space in all generality, but you can also think infinite dimension. It's just it can just be a typical conventional vector space. So generally, when we consider inverse problems, the observation operator A is underdetermined. So we cannot, without any more information, recover the unknown from the measurements. So we need a low-dimensional model set on the unknown x0, and I will model this model set by this is a, just I will just say that the unknown belong to the model set, to a set a subset of the D star A. So example of low-dimensional models. I come back to my three first examples. So I have low rank matrices. Here it's low rank symmetric matrices. What are these matrices? They are symmetric matrices of rank R. They are just the product of Z, the transpose of Z with Z belongs to R, P times R. We have the model of for off the grid sparse space recovery. This model, which I call sigma k epsilon, are sums of k spikes with generally make a separation assumptions on the position of the spikes to be able to have recovery guarantees, and the positions are on a bounded domain. Finally, we have the example of Gaussian mixtures. Here it's a sigma k epsilon gamma. Gamma will be it's a simple model of Gaussian mixture. Here all Gaussians will have the same covariance, so a possible model is the sum of k Gaussian measures. Here's the mu which have means ti, and similarly as in the sparse space model, we make the assumption that the means of the Gaussians here, Ti minus Tj, are separated with respect to a norm adapted to the covariance here. So we see that we can parameterize all these low dimensional models by parameters in RD. So to recover elements from this model, we consider the simple estimation method, which is generally non-convex and which we call the ideal decoder. This estimation method is just to minimize the L2 data fit function with respect to the constraint that the what we look at is in the low dimensional model. One first problem is when I want to study the performance guarantees of this method, how do I quantify the recovery when I don't have a norm attached to my space. If I am in the space of distribution, I don't have a natural norm to study recovery. So I will suppose that I have a metric, which I call here the norm H.
We have lost Ian again.
Which is yes.
Ian, we lost you again. Yes. So if you can restart from the last bullet, so we want.
Yeah. Sorry, I tried to. Do you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
I'm not sure if I should switch to the Wi-Fi or because I'm connected with a cable, but
yes, always dangerous to change right now.
I will stay like that. Okay.
Okay.
So yes, so I want to quantify the recovery the recovery of my unknown x0. So to measure the distance between my estimate x star between x0, I will suppose the existence of a Hilbert metric in the space I consider. So the main tool that we use to study the recovery guarantees is a restricted isometry property, and this property just says that my linear operator almost behaves like an isometry on a difference of elements of the log dimensional model. The most important part is the lower restricted isometry property, which is really, when you think about it, just an injectivity criterion on the low dimensional model set. Means if the norm of ax minus x prime is zero, it's implied that the distance between x and x prime is zero. So this property is a sufficient condition on the observation operator to guarantee the success of the ideal decoder in many examples, and it's also generally necessary to perform uniform recovery. So if I want to be able to recover all elements of the low dimensional model given one operator, this operator needs to have a restricted isometry property. And in all our examples, it's verified under a condition of the number of measurements, which is generally of the order of the number of parameters we need to estimate. I will give these results later when I will talk about each application. So this isometry property is with respect to the Hilbert norm we just suppose the existence. So for the example of low rank matrices, the Hilbert norm would just be the form Frobenius norm. So there's no problem to define it. But in finite sign measures, in the Banach space of finite sign measures, in which belong the Dirac case and the Gaussian mixture model estimation case, the restricted isometry property is generally not verified when we use the natural metric of the Banach space, which is the total variation for measures. But we can construct a Hilbert norm, which we call a kernel-induced norm, coming from the literature of replicable kernel Hilbert spaces, and they can just be seen as we take our elements from our model, so spikes, we filter them by a low pass filter, and we just take the L2 norm. So it can be seen as a distance measures at a given resolution, which we hope high enough to guarantee a reconstruction of the synapse. So if I detail a little more examples, what are measurements for the spike super resolution problem, or the even the Gaussian model estimation? We can, for example, use Fourier measurements. If I use regular Fourier measurements with a regular frequencies until maximum frequencies is equivalent to a low pass filter, but we can also do compressive sensing, compressive measurements of the grid compressive measurements, and then we can draw frequencies randomly according to Gaussian distribution, and this is also a possibility, and these operators will have a restricted isometry property. So to further understand a little more what are random measurements for spike super resolution in 2D, here is an example of simple back projection of 2000 random measurements of 100 spikes on a regular grid. So here it's the number of measurements is roughly 7 times the dimension of the model set. Okay, so we want to study the ideal decoder, but it's far from convex, so it can be NP-hard to perform the minimization. So how can we hope to have recovery guarantees for such problems? So this is what I will talk about now, and I will concentrate on the study of the basins of attraction of the global minimizers of this functional. So why study the basins of attraction? It's for the following reason. So lately, I'd say in the last 10 years, the same strategy was used to solve the non-convex problems for several different low-dimensional models. The strategy is really simple. Just perform a clever initialization, I'm missing, and apply a decent algorithm. So for example, a descent gradient. This strategy was used in phase recovery, in low rank matrix recovery, in blind deconvolution, and we used it in sparse spike estimation. And there are articles that began to understand that there was a common framework in these problems. So how can we guarantee the success of such methods? Because the problem is NP-hard, so it must not be that easy. Well, we have some way of making the problem more easy. We have conditions on the number of measurements, so I can try to see if when I use more measurements, if I will make the problem easier, and the dimensionality of the model set is fixed, so we have a low dimensional model, so we hope that we can do things a little easier because of this. So we will have success if when I use a decent algorithm, if when I initialize my gradient descent, my descent algorithm, I fall in a basin of attraction of the global minimizer of my function, which I will call G, in the space in which I do the gradient descent. So if I want to be able to guarantee the success, I will have to study the basins of attraction of the problem. So of what minimization I will talk exactly, I will consider problems which can be smoothly parameterized in RD, possibly with the constraint of on the set on which we minimize. So I minimize my functional G, which is just the same data feed, but my variable which was moving in the low dimensional model sigma is now phi of theta, with phi the parameterization functional, and theta belongs to RD, in a set big theta, which is the pre-image of the low-dimensional model sigma. So this is a very classical non-linear least squares method. So my aim really is to try to see if with the simplest method of estimation, I will be able to have recovery guarantees, or at least to have information on the geometry of this functional. So examples of parametrizations for low rank matrices. My parametrization is just I take the low rank factor and I do the square of this low rank factor. For sparse packed recovery, my parameters are amplitudes and positions, and my functional which associates to these amplitudes and positions, just the sums of the spikes. And for Gaussian mixtures, I will have amplitudes and means, and my parametrization functional will associate to these amplitudes and means the sums of these Gaussians. It must be noted that these models do not include conventional sparsity in finite dimension, unless it's considered as a special case of the infinite dimensional case. Okay. So I will minimize on a parameter space theta, big theta, and I will just consider, just for simplicity, fixed step gradient descent here. And I will say that a set big lambda is a basin of attraction of my minimizer, my global minimizer theta star, if when I initialize in this set, I have convergence of the sequence of the g theta n. Why consider this sequence of the g theta n instead of theta n? It's for the generative purpose, but we have a guarantee of convergence of we will have guarantee of convergence of the theta also thanks to the restricted isometry property. So how do we prove the convergence of a gradient descent? In all our examples, the function is very smooth, in fact. So the smoothness is not really a problem. And so we just make sure that the Hessian is positive on the set lambda and that it iterates stay in this set big lambda. So it's very conventional property. There's just one problem, is that in the low rank case, there's an indeterminacy which induce a local non-convexity of the functional. So we need to tweak a little the arguments to make it work in the general case. And this little tweak is the following. So if I wanted to consider L2 ball as a basin of attraction, it would not work in the low rank case. This is because different parametrization are equivalent. So we need to use a distance to a set of equivalent parametrizations instead of just a L2 distance on the set of parameters. So this distance, I just look at the minimum distance between equivalent parametrization. So this is not symmetrical anymore, but we look at the parameters that minimize the distance to the set of equivalent representations of theta equal here. And then I can consider shape of basins of attractions that are lambda beta, so the size is beta, are all the parameters which are at a distance lower than beta than the closest equivalent representation of the global minimizer. Okay, now I have all the tools to describe our main result. So it's a little technical, but it's not that difficult. It's just all natural hypothesis. So I need two slides to describe the hypothesis for our theorem. So I need my operator A, my operator A to be continuous, weak star continuous, because we are in general settings. I suppose that my operator A has a restricted isometry on the set of difference of elements of sigma with a given constant. And I need that my parametrization functional to be continuous and differentiable with respect to a notion that is adapted to the ambient pace, which is a weak star Gato differentiability. It is really just the existence of directional derivatives. So I take a global minimizer, and we need the existence of a distance where we have stability of where we have inclusion of a set lambda 2 beta 1, which is included in the low dimensional model. And we have some regularity conditional conditions on the parametrization functional. You see here we have a kind of Lipschitz property and boundedness of the derivatives of this function. So just a comment on this hypothesis. So the weak star continuity, it's by construction, it's always verified by our operator A. Just to know that. In all our examples, we can guarantee that the operator A has the restricted isometry on the set sigma minus sigma, which we call the second set. For the differentiability of our parametrization functional, in the Laurent case, it is immediate. It's just a bilinear function. For the spiked super resolution, the Gato derivatives of phi, they just give the directional derivative of Dirac. So these are distributions of order one, so they exist and it's okay. And for Gato derivatives of Gaussian mixtures, it's equivalent to directional derivatives of their density, so it's okay, they exist as well. So all our technical hypotheses, the regularity hypotheses, are verified in our examples, and we can state theorem. So I have a size beta 2, which depends on parameters of the problem, which I will comment a little, and my basin of attraction will be of the size this beta 2, the mean of the beta 1, which was used to guarantee the inclusion in the low dimensional model, and the size beta 2. So what are the parameters that are involved in this bound? So this is the size of the basin of attraction. We have a noisy term here, which can be problematic, but we just suppose for the sake of discussion that it is zero. What is important here is that we have the restricted isometry constants, explicit constants that depends on the parametrization functionals. And here a bound which is generally which is in our examples depend is a non-zero, and there here the operator A, which when we calculate in this bound, there's another square root of 1 plus gamma that gets out of this expression. So what's interesting is that we link the size of the basin of attraction with the restricted isometry constant. So another thing is with this theorem, it's what I was telling you before, is that because we have the restricted isometry, we can guarantee the convergence of the iterate. Here we didn't look at strong convexity, so we just guarantee slow convergence. But we conjecture that if we were looking at a strong convexity, we would have better rate of convergence. So the link, why is the link with the restricted isometry constant is important? It's because it's directly linked with the number of measurements. We can generally construct operators with a restricted isometry gamma such that the number of measurements is of the order, the dimension over gamma square. So qualitatively, in my bounds for the Bessing of attraction, I can replace my RIP constant gamma by a square root of 1 over m, with m the number of measurements. So I directly have with this Mesa theorem Bessing of attraction that depends on the number of measurements. And what we see is that when the number of measurements increases, the RIP constant has a tendency to decrease, and so the size of the basin of attraction increases as well, possibly not strictly, because there is here it's the minimum of two constants here. So how does this translate in application? So for the Laurent matrix estimation, which we use really as a sanity check of the general theory, because now there are studies that show that we have global convergence with stochastic gradient descent. But there were the results from five years ago or so that we are looking at the basins of attraction of in this case. So the ideal decoder is the this minimization here. It's called the Beurer-Montero method. And the basin of attraction has a shape here where we look at the distance with equivalent parametrization. So the parametrizations are equivalent up to multiplication by an orthogonal matrix. And so the theorem lists with the restricted isometry on sigma 2R, well, so on matrices of rank 2R with a constant gamma. So this is possible theoretically with a number of measurements of order P for P times R. We have a basin of attraction of the size which depends on the 1 minus gamma over 1 plus gamma, which is the what I was telling you, the dependency on the restricted isometry constant. So in green, it was just what was better than the results from the literature, and in red, what was added from the results from the literature. So we attribute this to the generality of the approach, the fact that we have another constant here which depends on the conditioning of our matrix. Okay, now we have the problem of sparse path recovery. So this was the first problem we used in our first paper. We gave the basins of attraction for the sparse path recovery with the same technique. So in this talk, it's really the generalization of this work. And what we found is that, okay, so we have the, we minimize with respect to the amplitudes and position functional. The shape of the basin here is just the L2 ball in the parameter space. So with the restricted isometry property this set of difference of Dirac epsilon over 2 separated, this is possible with a number of measurements of K2 of order K2 times D, K is number of of Dirac's ND is the dimensionality of the domain. We have a basin of attraction which depends on the minimal the separation between Dirac's, which makes sense because if I initialize too far from my Dirac's, it will not work. It depends also on the lowest the minimum amplitude in my sum of spikes. This is because I studied the gradient descent with respect to amplitudes and position at the same time. So this is even most necessary, and the constant which depends on 1 minus gamma over 1 plus gamma, where gamma is the RIP, the restricted isometry constant. So we have the same behavior with respect to the number of measurements than in the lower rank matrix estimation, provided we are already close enough to the optimal solution. And finally, for Gaussian mixtures, so this was satisfying because the general framework, we could just use it and apply it to this new model, and it gives similar sizes of basins of attractions. So the ideal decoder, it's really similar to the Dirac case, where I minimize here over amplitudes and the means of the Gaussian mu. The shape of the basin is just a L2 ball, and with a restricted isometry property, which is guaranteed for a number of measurements of order K2 times D, if the separation is large enough, we have a basin of attraction with a condition of the separation with a size which depends on the separation between Gaussians. The minimum amplitudes of the Gaussian, A1 it's a minimum amplitude, and the constant which also depends on 1 minus gamma over 1 plus gamma. So we have still the same behavior with respect to the number of measurements. So in all generality, it's really the contribution of this work. We linked the size of this, the geometry, the local geometry, well, the a little more than local geometry of the global minimizer of the non-convex inverse problem with the number of measurements, and we see that it becomes easier as we add the measurements for the recovery. So just to tell you what is the possible application of the problem of Gaussian mixtures. Actually, we do a lot of gradient descents in the problem of compressive learning, where we use continuous orthogonal matching pursuits algorithm to recover the Gaussian. So the algorithm is from linear measurements. We add one by one Gaussian components by maximizing correlation with the residual, and then we perform descents on all parameters. So there was no explanation in the literature on why this should work to do this descent on all parameters. Well, this is a first step to understand the convergence of this greedy algorithm. If the step of adding an atom is close enough to the global minimum, the gradient descent will converge to the right thing for this greedy method. And so this is, for example, this greedy methods on Gaussian is something we used for compressive learning, for image denoising in the space of patches, so in a kind of high dimensional space. So now I've studied the basins of attraction, but you will tell me, yeah, but we need to initialize. So this is not trivial, and indeed it's not. So what can we say about the initialization? There's a very simple observation. Is when we consider the ideal back projection in the pre-dual space, we just sum the contribution of each measurement, YL here, with their corresponding measurement function alpha L. We can simply prove with the restricted isometry property that the duality product between what we look and the ideal projection localizes the energy of the unknown up to a rip constant. So I have a very simple way to localize approximately where is my signal. The only problem is that this ideal back projection, it belongs to the pre-dual space D, which is, for example, for Dirac, it's a bounded continuous smooth functions. So the problem is, how can I go from this ideal back projection to an initial parameter theta in it? This is an open question in many cases, but there's still some hope. And for example, in 2D, 3D imaging, we tried a very simple simple way of initializing. This initialization rely on two main components. One is to overparameterize the initialization. So this is just I will start my descent with more spike than I need, and I will do a projection to reduce the number of spikes, to merge the spikes that are really close, because I want to recover spikes that are separated by epsilon. And we do that, and we just do a hard thresholding on a grid with a step which is of the order of the precision that we want. So there's still a gridding step here, so it's kind of not looking good if I want to be in very high dimension, but still, for 2D and 3D imaging, this is accessible. So we did this. So here we have the back projection of five random Fourier measurements of five spikes. We just look at the biggest amplitudes here on the grid, and we keep the biggest amplitudes. And we see here that for each spike, we will have several spikes, and we do a projected gradient descent. We have a convergence, and then it will merge the spikes that are close to converge to the true position. If I look at and the problem is that if I just keep the gradient descent without the projection step, the convergence is very slow, because I will have it will be badly conditioned, because I will have more spikes than I need to explain one spike. So if I look at with more spikes, here I have 100 spikes with random Fourier measurements. It's the image I showed you at the beginning. Using this method is showing good results, and it's really faster than the other method that were working well, the continuous orthogonal matching pursuit. So even here, adding a simple algorithmic step on a grid, so this step is fast. The operations are easy to do on the grid. It's faster to use a grid than to use a fully gridless continuous orthogonal matching pursuit. I come to my conclusion, and in this talk I gave a general framework for the study of the geometry of the global minimizer of non-convex methods to solve inverse problems with low dimensional models. I gave explicit sizes of basins of attractions linked with the number of measurements. So for future work, for the Gaussian mixture model, we can ask ourselves, can we do things with a variable covariance, because it's a more useful model. Here, I just gave sufficient conditions. Are these results tight? Experiments in the sparse sparse spike recovery tends to show that it looks tight, the dependency on the number of measurements. And the big question, is there a systematic approach to initialization, or how do I initialize? For example, in the Gaussian mixture model, it's not clear how we can initialize the problem. In the sparse spike case, we have, I think we are close to finding ways to initialize with a fully gridless method. So, but this is work still. We are still consolidating. So I'll talk about it in a few months. So this concludes my work. These are all articles that I took things from for this presentation. So thank you. I think I'm on time.
Yes, thank you very much, Yann. It was very interesting, very clear slides. We clap virtually our hands. So we have time for questions. So
I couldn't see your faces during the talk, so I don't know if it was clear or not. So.
It was very clear. I don't see any question in the chat, but don't hesitate to ask yours if you have one, or to switch on your mic.
I have a question.
Yes,
Laurent.
Go ahead.
So it's a very naive question. I would like to know. I'm not really familiar with this continuous formalism of sparse recovery, but I have a question. If you want to solve the same problem by using discrete formulation, it won't perform as well, probably, because you won't have the same precision. For instance, if you minimize the L2 norm of A. X minus y plus a sparsity assumption on your data, and then you solve the problem. If you have a L1 norm, you know that in terms of optimization, everything is quite okay. You know that you are going to converge to a solution where you have guarantees. Okay, but then you are going to have an imprecision due to the discretization. Mm-hmm. On your side, it's different because you are more accurate in terms of model, because you are going to design a continuous optimization, but you are going to lose due to the optimization part. Because you are not as, the guarantees are not as strong as the one you will have in the discrete part. Maybe I'm wrong on that. And my question is, do you have any way to measure the accuracy in the non-convex part, and in order to compare to maybe the accuracy in the discrete part, which will be related to the resolution of the problem?
This is not clear how the discrete and the continuous parts compare. The problem is that we have for now, we just have qualitative results. In terms of accuracy, if I am within the hypothesis of the theorem in the continuous case, let's say in the noiseless case, I have perfect accuracy if I have converged. And in terms of recovery guarantees, this is not clear. Is it sufficient to? How many measurements do I need to be able to match the initialization in the basin of attraction. So we still don't know. It's I don't have the answer of this. So
Yes, maybe something is not clear for me, because the fact that you are going to be in the basin of attraction, you have some assumption, you have some in order to be sure that you are going to converge on the good location. And yeah. My question is there any way to compare the assumption you need to ensure that with, on the other side, assumption related to the discretization?
For now, no, I don't think so. Because for now, I don't know how many measurements I need exactly, quantitatively, to solve my problem with this method. Like, the convergence proof is not complete. I need to be able to guarantee that I fall given a number of measurements. So it's still, but to do that, it's kind of linked with the tightness of the results. If I want to do that, I want to have sizes of basins of attraction that are as tight as possible, because I want them as big as possible. So it's still the big open question for the general proof of such methods.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, I guess there are connections also with the context of infinite compressive sensing in the context of sparse spike recovery. So not sure if maybe it's not clear exactly how to compare everything. I agree with you, Ian, and yeah, seems to be a difficult question. There is a question from Gilles Menoyer. Gilles, it's up to you. Either you ask it by yourself by switching on your microphone, or I ask myself. Just tell me by the chat.
Okay, I can ask myself.
Okay.
So I was just wondering about the initialization. I guess the choice of back projection is for the simulation and stuff is more related to have a simple way of initializing. I was wondering if just to keep a very simple and fast initialization, some heuristic greedy methods such as an over-parameterized OMP, for instance, could provide a stronger initialization. Because, for instance, the back projection, if you have some strong spikes somewhere and a very weak spike far away in the parameter region, the back projection could completely miss the weak spike, and so you will not be able to converge. And maybe some heuristic, greedy methods can provide better initialization. But I wonder if, in terms of computation time, it is worth or not. If you have
so it is a very good idea, because this is the idea we are pursuing. we have results, and we should have some in 2 months or so. We should publish things related to this. The problem with there's a problem. The problem is we want to make things faster than the continuous orthogonal matching pursuit, because there is the gradient descent step each time we add an atom. So at the end of the over parameterization, if you do this gradient descent, it will be the cost of just a gradient descent with a simple initialization. But there is a way to simplify things to make it work. Yeah.
Yes. One comment. In some kind of continuous OMP, because there are, I guess, different way of seeing the continuous version of OMP, you solve a gradient descent, but you solve it at each iteration for one scalar parameter.
No, for all parameters.
Oh, for all. Okay, because yeah. I've seen in different papers, different ways of applying a continuous OMP, and sometimes you just optimize.
If you optimize for one parameter. Well, actually, yes, that's the thing. If you optimize on one parameter, you need to practically.
So of course it will be it will be suboptimal doing so, but maybe to provide a good initialization
In practice, it works. Yeah.
Okay. So thanks for your answer and for the presentation. It was very good.
Yeah. Thank you, Gilles. I have a question myself. If there is
a question from Simon, I think.
Oh, Simon, sorry.
Yes, if I may. Thank you for your talk. So I wanted to ask you about whether a similar analysis could be applied for the sparse case. So like the finite compress sensing case. So in that scenario, basically the sensing matrix and the RIP of the sensing matrix also acts as kind of Hessian for the linear regression model. So basically the number of measurements also changes the properties of the Hessian. So in some way it seems similar.
It's similar.
So I wanted to ask if similar kind of thing could be done also for compress sensing problem. And the other question I had was whether you could say something about non-uniform guarantees using this analysis.
Yeah, the problem with compress sensing, in finite dimension, I don't know how to do a gradient descent in the model because it's not. That is a problem. I don't know. You don't have balls included in the model. So that's the problem. So, but there might be other ways to look at it. I don't know of them. So that's why I cannot apply this in the finite dimensional case. For the non-uniform, we could look at the non-uniform. It's just that the guarantees in the non-uniform case there are guarantees, but just more for a convex formulation. So we need to look at exactly how we guarantee things in the non-uniform case. So I don't expect much differences, but I don't know. So it's open to do the same studies in the non-uniform case.
Thank you.
So. There's a question for Martin Kenzel.
Yeah, I guess it's a bit related to the question about the non-uniformity. So can you comment on the necessity of using the RIP in your analysis?
Yeah, by the way, thanks for the great talk. So I think in one of your earlier slides, you mentioned that the RIP is like a necessary condition. I was wondering in how far this is like really like a strict statement. So like there is no weaker condition that can guarantee uniform recovery, or is this like there are situations where it's necessary?
For uniform, if you have uniform recovery, there is a restricted isometry property for some norm which are lower. There is a lower restricted isometry property for some adapted norms. So it's kind of the statement is kind of, it's you need to specify it a little, but it's a. In this way, it's the paper from Anthony Bourrier, Rémy Gribonval, Mike Davis, and so yes, but it might not be the case in I don't know what was the context. Maybe it was Hilbert spaces or metric spaces. So I don't know exactly in which generalities they did this. I don't remember in which generality they did this thing. So this is it. But actually, to obtain tight size of basins of attraction, we would like more to do the non-uniform study. I find it more difficult with the dual certificate and stuff, but for the non-convex case, I don't know. I haven't looked at it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
You're welcome.
Okay, I have a last question maybe, and after we will have to switch to the next speaker. So I was wondering, so it's two questions inside one, but on one side, I see that you are somehow in your analysis bound to use the standard RIP property, which is the L2 RIP property. And on the other side, I was wondering if your model could afford to use some nonlinear sensing model. So for instance, combining the sensing matrix with a one-bit quantization operator, so just keeping the sign of the measurements. And in that case, there are results in the literature that tells that at least in the finite setting, you need to consider another RIP property, which is the L1, L2 RIP property. And so I was wondering if in your case, you foresee somehow potential extensions of what you did to a nonlinear sensing model with or without the use of other RIP properties?
It's really important to, if it's L1, it cannot be the TV norm in the space of measures, because this would not work. If it's L1 adapted in a kernel-like manner, maybe this is possible. I think.
But it will be L1 in the range of the operator A.
It's in the range of the operator. If it's in the range of the operator, yes, I think it could be possible.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's not. It's the same. It's just we are in this infinite dimensional context. I don't think there are results with such a restricted symmetry. Yes, no.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that. So maybe it would be interesting, yes, to show if we can show recovery guarantees with mm-hmm. such restricted isometries in the grid context.
Mm-hmm.
Because from what I know, there are no results like that.
Yeah, the problem also is that somehow it's still very restricted to Gaussian sensing matrices, and then it will be very difficult for Fourier measurement as you
do. Yeah, Fourier.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.